فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
بعد قول الله تعالى: ومن يبتغي غير الاسلام دينا فلن يقبل منه. وعن ابي هريره رضي الله عنه قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: تجيء الاعمال يوم القيامه فتجيء الصلاه فتقول: يا رب انا الصلاه، فيقول: انك على خير. ثم تجيء الصدقه فتقول: يا رب انا الصدقه، فيقول: انك على خير. ثم يجيء الصيام فيقول: يا رب انا الصيام، فيقول: إنك على خير. ثم تجيء الأعمال على ذلك فيقول: إنك على خير. ثم يجيء الإسلام فيقول: يا ربي أنت الإسلام وأنا السلام وأنا الإسلام، فيقول: إنك على خير. بك اليوم آخذ وبك أعطي. قال الله تعالى في كتابه: ومن يبتغي غير الإسلام دينا فلن يقبل منه وهو في الآخرة من الخاسرين. رواه الإمام أحمد. وفي الصحيح عن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. رواه الإمام أحمد.
The author رحمه الله he placed a chapter which he called it Babu قَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, the chapter of the statement of Allah, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِي غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ. Anyone who tries to look for a religion in other than Islam, or looks for a religion other than Islam, فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ, it will not be accepted from him. This chapter is to show the falsehood of all other religions other than the religion of Islam. And it won't be accepted from the individual, it will be rejected, and everything in that religion which he does will be rejected. And everything that's rejected is falsehood. So all religions other than Islam are falsehood. The religions that are other than the religion, salaam alaikum, the religion that exists other than Islam are two types. Adyan al-mushtamila ala ma yukhalifu da'wat al-anbiya'i jami'an min tawheedillah. Religions that consist of things that oppose the message of the prophets, all of them, like Tawheed. All of those religions are batil, whether it's before Islam or even after Islam. The second type of religions are al-adyan allati ja'a biha al-anbiya, religions which prophets came with. Those religions are batil, but after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came. And that the Prophet's religion abrogated all of those religions. But before the Prophet came, it was a religion that was followed, because it was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The author mentioned three evidences for this chapter. The first one is قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى, the statement of Allah, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينَ. The dilala, the way he's trying to extract ruling from this verse, is فَلَنْ يُقُبَلَ مِنْهُ, it will not be accepted from them. And anything that's not accepted from the person, it is rejected at the person. And everything that is rejected is evidence to show that it's falsehood. So every religion other than Islam is a religion which is false. And the people who are coming with it, they are working inside what is falsehood and misguidance. The second evidence is the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تَجِيءُ الْأَعْمَالُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, that the actions will come the day of judgment. And the hadith is lengthy. And Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad وَإِسْنَادُهُ ضَعِيفٌ and its chain of narration is weak. And the way that the author is trying to extract ruling from this hadith for the chaptering is Islam will come. From within the narration it says, ثُمَّ يَجِيءُ الْإِسْلَامُ إِسْلَامُ will come. فَيَقُولُ إِسْلَامُ say, يَا رَبُّ my Lord, أَنْتَ السَّلَامُ وَأَنَا الْإِسْلَامُ. Oh Allah, you are peace and I am Islam. فَيَقُولُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ and Allah will say, إِنَّكَ عَلَى خَيْرٍ you are upon good. بِكَ الْيَوْمَ آخُذُ وَبِكَ أُعْطِي. Based on you I will give and based on you I will take. And then the messenger recited the verse, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. And the recitation of the Prophet ﷺ for the verse to this hadith, it means that he's in agreement with it. That the person will be saved and success will be given to them. And also the person will be destroyed, all based upon the religion which they have taken. فَمَنْ أَسْلَمَ نَجَى. Anyone who takes Islam as a religion, he will find success. وَمَنْ لَمْ يُسْلِمْ. And anyone who doesn't take Islam as a religion, خَسِرَ وَخَاب. Then that person is lost and destroyed. And what is it that can necessitate destruction for you? It's something that is falsehood. So all religions other than Islam are false. The reason is because لِأَنَّهَا تُوجِبُ خُسْرَانَ الْعَبْدِ. It will bring about destruction for the person the day of judgment. The third evidence that the author uses is the hadith of Aisha, in which Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih, and it is wording, and the hadith is also narrated with its meaning in Sahih al-Bukhari, with a different wording. That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدْ. Anyone who does an action that is not from our affairs, it will be rejected. And the author, rahimahullah, he said, Rawahu al-Imam Ahmad, Imam Ahmad narrated this. And he followed it up with attributing this hadith to Musnad Imam Ahmad. And the reason why he done that is because لِكَوْنِهِ مِنْ أَتْبَاعِ مَذْهَبِهِ, because he's from the people who attribute himself to Madhab Imam Ahmad. The Hanabila are different from the normal scholars when it comes to attributing hadith. They generally mention the hadith, if it's in Musnad Imam Ahmad, they like to always bring it back to him. And they like to add him onto the list of scholars who are mentioned. Like generally, if the hadith is in Bukhari or Muslim, or if it's in both of them, we would just stop there. But they like to bring Musnad Imam Ahmad in there. ولذلك, if you look at Ibn Taymiyyah al-Jaddi, the grandfather of Ibn Taymiyyah al-Harran, Ibn Taymiyyah al-Hafid, his grandfather, he has a book called Al-Muntaqa fi al-Ahkam. And it's a book that Shawkani explains. Nail al-Awtar is a sharah of Al-Muntaqa. He used the word muttafaqun alayh. And what does muttafaqun alayh mean? It means Bukhari and Muslim both agreed upon it. That's what muttafaqun alayh means. It means agreed upon. And the agreeing upon here only means Bukhari and Muslim. But what he did was, he believes muttafaqun alayh is Bukhari and Muslim and Ahmad. That's a term he coined. And that's something that they do, the Hanabila. So when he says, Al-Imam Ibn Taymiyyah al-Jadd, when he says in his Muntaqa, muttafaqun alayhi, he means Rawahu al-Bukhari wa Muslim wa Ahmad fi Musnadi. The dilala of this hadith, laysa alayhi amruna, is what he wants from the hadith. Laysa alayhi amruna. فَهُوَ رَدٌّ, it is rejected. The word al-amr in the hadith means deen al-Islam, the religion of Islam. So what the hadith means is, فَمَا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ دِينُ الْإِسْلَامِ. Anything that the religion of Islam is not upon, for مَرْدُودٍ, then it's rejected to the person. And anything that's مَرْدُود is باطل. So all of the religions other than Islam are false. لِأَنَّذِ, because لَيْسَتْ مِنْ أَمْرِنَا, it's not from our affairs. And it's not from the affairs of Islam. نعم.
باب وجوب الاستغناء بمتابعة الكتاب عن كل ما سواه وقول الله تعالى ونزلنا عليك الكتاب تبيانا لكل شيء رواه النسائي وغيره عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه رأى في يد عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه ورقة من التوراة فقال أمتهوكون يا ابن الخطاب لقد جئتكم بها بيضاء نقية لو كان موسى حيا واتبعتموه وتركتموني ضللتم وفي رواية لو كان موسى حيا ما وسعه إلا اتباعي فقال عمر رضينا بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد رسولا.
The author رحمه الله, here he speaks about and he clarifies وجوب الاستغناء, that it's obligatory. الاستغناء means what? طلب الغنى. استغناء means طلب الغنى, is to look for sufficiency. بمتابعة الكتاب, by following the Quran. عن جميع ما سواه, over everything else there is. والمتابعة, بمتابعة الكتاب عن كل ما سواه. And following, and the word mutaba'a means imtithalu ma fihi, adhering to what is in it. So the person, according to the statement of the author, should be sufficed in following the Quran. And a person is not in need of nothing other than it. والاستغناء بالقرآن له موردان عظيمان. To be sufficed by the Quran, it holds two powerful points, or it implies two things. The first is الاستغناء بما فيه من الخبر. All of the akhbar and news that are in the Quran, that you are sufficed and that's sufficient for you, you shouldn't look for any other news other than it. The second one is الاستغناء به في باب الطلب. And also to be sufficed by the Quran in terms of jurisprudent rulings. The author says عن كل ما سواه. عن كل ما سواه means two things. That you are sufficed with the Quran over what? Everything other than it. So that's عن كل ما سواه means two things. ما تقدمه من الكتب المنزلة على الأنبياء. All of the previous sent books on prophets. Whether it be Torah, whether it be Injil, whether it be Zabur, all the books that have been sent down before us. All of them. We don't need them anymore. We're not in need of it because we have the Quran. The reason is because this Quran is muhaiminun alayha nasikhun laha fala kitaba lillah yuhkamu bihi ba'dahu illahu. It abrogates all of the previous books. All of the previous books are now abrogated. They are null and void. The second is آراء الخلق ومقالاتهم. Statements and opinions that people have come with. People's opinions. People's statements. To also be sufficed from that. You have the Quran, you're not in need of that anymore. And the author, rahimahullah, he mentions two evidences to support this heading that he has brought. The first one is, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. Allah says to the Messenger, we sent down the Quran on you, تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ, to clarify everything. And the way that the author is trying to use this and support his is تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ, to clarify everything for everybody. Everything that the people are in need of, في أمر الدنيا والآخرة, in matters of this dunya and the matters of the hereafter, it's upon you, O Messenger Muhammad, to clarify for them. So this Quran came to clarify everything for us. And the clarification of the Quran entails that you don't need anything else to clarify something for you. The Quran is already doing that. تِبْيَانَ لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. The word تِبْيَان means what? إِضَاح لِكُلِّ مَا يَحْتَاجُهُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ أَمْرِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ, is to clarify everything that the slave needs in his worldly matters and in his hereafter affairs. That's the first evidence that the author brought. The second evidence that the author brought, is hadith anna Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the messenger ra'a fi yadi Umar ibn al-Khattab, that the messenger saw in the hand of Umar ibn al-Khattab waraqatan min al-Tawrah. He saw a waraqa, paper of Tawrat in his hand. And this is narrated by Imam Ahmad in his Musnad. من حديث جابر رضي الله تعالى عنه وإسناده ضعيف. Its chain of narration is weak. But the hadith has been narrated من وجوه عديدة, from different ways. مجموعها, all of them when they come together, it shows and it proves inshallah تعالى أن للحديث أصلا, that the hadith has some foundation. That the hadith has a what? That the hadith has an أصل. As Abu al-Fadl ibn Hajar al-Asqalani mentions. The author, on the other hand, here, he attributed it to who? An-Nasa'i. He said, Imam al-Nasa'i narrated it. And if you now go to the Sunan al-Nasa'i today, you won't find that hadith in there. Even that though, he's not the only person, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, attributed this hadith to Sunan Nasa'i. Before him, Ibn Taymiyyah al-Hafid. And when I say Hafid, I mean the Ibn Taymiyyah that we know. But when I say Ibn Taymiyyah al-Jadd, what do I mean? The granddad. They're all known as Ibn Taymiyyahs. He attributes this hadith to Sunan Nasa'i. Even Abu al-Fida ibn Kathir rahimahullah attributes this hadith to Sunan Nasa'i. Even Abu Abdullah ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, he attributes this hadith to Sunan Nasa'i. All of them did. So what we could say is that this hadith is mafqood. It's from the lost hadith that were in Sunan Nasa'i, al-Sughra, and also al-Kubra. So it could be possible that this hadith was in Sunan Nasa'i, but it didn't reach us, it got lost. And sometimes it does happen. لذلك, sometimes people, they don't find a hadith in a particular book, or they don't find a statement in a particular book. When they look back to reference it, if it's there, and when they don't find it, they think to themselves that this scholar got it wrong in attributing it to this book. But it doesn't necessarily mean, because they saw these manuscripts way before you did. It could have fallen in one of the manuscripts which you've never seen. So it could be missing from the copies that we have today. Now, for example, Ibn Hazm rahimahullah, he attributes to Tirmidhi that he's somebody who's unknown. Ibn Hazm says Tirmidhi is unknown. He's criticizing the Tirmidhi. And this is something Ibn Hajar attributed to him, that he said this. Now, if we look at the works of Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri today, whether it be the Kitab al-Ihkam, or even if it's the Kitab al-Fisal fil Milal wal-Ahwa' wal-Nihal, or any of his works, you don't find that statement anywhere to be found.